Dear friends, in this episode of your FinTech Capsule Explainer Series, I'll cover a topic that is being actively discussed today, Central Bank Digital Currencies, or CBDCs in short. I'll explain what they are, where we are in their development, and why this matters, not only for central banks, policymakers, and banks, but also for you as the end user. Here we go. To start, what is a CBDC? A CBDC is a new digital form of central bank money, equal to physical cash or reserves that your commercial bank holds at the central bank. But wait a second, you may say that you already have digital cash, since everything you use, from your credit card to your favorite payment app to basic bank transfers, involves using digital money. Well, not quite. Yes, those online transactions and payments are digital, but in reality, there are just debits and credits, or say plus and minuses, between two different providers, like banks to payment companies. Real central bank money is a component of the monetary base and a direct liability of the central bank. Today, that practically exists only in two forms. First is the physical cash that you hold in your hands and you can see. The other, which you don't see, are the reserves that your bank holds at the central bank. CBDCs could constitute a third, a new form of central bank money, and that is a big deal. It is important to understand that there are two major types of CBDCs. First is what we call wholesale CBDC, which would be used to facilitate payments only between banks and a central bank or other entities that have an account at the central bank itself. A lot of work has been done on this in recent years, from Canada and South Africa to Hong Kong and Thailand. While the development of wholesale CBDC is important, it does not affect you directly as a member of the public. It relates more to the piping of a transfer of money between banks and central banks that takes place behind the scenes. The second type of CBDC is what we call retail CBDC, which can be used by the public and businesses for everything from payments to savings, very similar to banknotes today. And this is a complicated topic, and it has numerous implications, from financial stability to financial inclusion. For this reason, a lot of central banks and policymakers had pushed off exploring retail CBDCs to the far-off future. But then Facebook's Libra was announced in June 2019 that brought retail CBDC to the top of the agenda for all major policymakers and central banks around the world. Basically, no central bank wants a Facebook-backed currency or any other form of private money to be created that could potentially threaten the existing forms of money issued by central banks. Over the last couple of months, there have been numerous papers or experiments done on retail CBDC from various countries, from the UK and China to the Bahamas and Cambodia. Also, numerous global policymakers like the BIS, the FSB, or the FATF have published papers on this topic. So you may wonder, what are central banks thinking when it comes to retail CBDC? While central banks generally are not big fans of decentralized cryptocurrencies like Bitcoin, as they cannot control the total supply as they do with traditional money, there are some features of Bitcoin and cryptocurrencies that central banks love. First, they allow for better monitoring and visibility of the economic activity in a country. Today, the central bank has no visibility on transactions made with cash. While this is great for businesses who are trying to avoid paying taxes, this is not great for the broader monetary or fiscal policy of any country. With a CBDC, the central bank will be able to see, to a certain degree, all transactions carried out and thus be able to reduce financial risk. Second, CBDCs offer a great fighting chance against money laundering. Today, physical banknote represents the most private, anonymous method of payment. It is not a surprise that it is still used a lot for illicit activities, from drug and human trafficking to money laundering. A CBDC could, for the first time, give us a fighting chance against money laundering. It's a massive global problem. It's estimated that the amount of money laundered each year represents between 2 to 5% of global GDP, according to the United Nations. Third, CBDCs can help with financial inclusion, especially in difficult times like we are going through with the coronavirus pandemic. As people shy away from using cash, where the dollar bills and coins could carry the virus, two categories of people are negatively impacted. First, the elderly, who tend to be less tax savvy when it comes to digital payments. And second, those who are unbanked or underbanked as they don't have a bank account or access to formal financial services. Because they don't have a bank account to send to, many governments around the world are having trouble sending COVID relief funds to the unbanked or underbanked, despite the fact that they're often the people who need it the most. For example, it was reported that the US IRS had to send over 100 million COVID-19 relief checks by mail. With a digital CBDC, money can be sent easily to everyone. For example, to a CBDC digital app or wallet that can be installed in every single smartphone, thus allowing the government to send out funds quickly and effectively. And a blockchain-based CBDC allowed numerous new possibilities that are not possible today, from having programmable money via smart contracts that allow us to input monetary policy like interest rates directly on the CBDC, to being able to do micropayments seamlessly in a world connected by the Internet of Things devices. While this is very exciting and truly shows the potential of the future of money, there are potential downsides as well, especially for traditional financial institutions. First, there is the risk of disintermediation of banks. If you replace your $1 banknote with a $1 CBDC, the impact is limited. But if the public starts substituting their bank balances with CBDC, then this reduces the bank balances that banks hold, increases their funding costs, and reduces their profitability. The bigger risk for central banks is that in the event of a crisis, a CBDC can accelerate a run on the banks. For example, today, if you do not trust a banking system, you can go to an ATM and withdraw all your money in cash. However, there are physical limitations to how much you can withdraw from an ATM, let alone all the practical challenges with how you will secure and keep these banknotes safely. In a CBDC world, you could quickly remove your funds held at your bank and hold them in your digital wallet. And unlike paper banknotes, there is no limit on how much you can store digitally. Central banks and your bank are fully aware of this risk, and this is why many CBDC initiatives have tried to put various restrictions, from a maximum amount of CBDCs someone is allowed to hold in their CBDC wallet to having a lower interest rate on CBDC than for bank deposits, so people have an incentive to keep their money in traditional banks. The other concern is privacy. While having the central bank be able to see all transactions in the country is great to combat money laundering or corruption, it also raises privacy concerns. So expect to see a lot of activity in this space over the coming months. I'll try to cover them as best as I can to keep you all posted in my weekly Crypto Capsule videos or my weekly Future of Money newsletter. You see, who said that the future of money was not exciting? If there is any topic you want me to explain or any question you want me to answer, feel free to let me know in the comments below. Hope this was a useful video, and stay tuned for another FinTech Capsule Explainer Series soon.